it's Fran again at the bench with a little thing here that I had to pop out of the socket because it's burned out. It's an IKEA brand LED replacement bulb for some track lighting. It replaces the original halogen bulbs. These things were very popular in sort of those mini track lights that they have in sort of kitchens and stuff like that. And this one I installed about a year ago, and it's had about 12 months of life, and I wanted to pop it open, take a look inside of exactly what it takes to go from a very simple resistive tungsten bulb to, you know, something that runs on a light emitting diode. It's not as straightforward as you might think, and it's actually quite surprising just how much goes into this kind of substitution. So let's take a look. Okay, here's the lamp. Check it out on the outside. It's a glass case. It's actually molded glass, and the face is actually plastic. Feels like polycarbonate. It's probably not acrylic, just because of the, you know, but it's some kind of high melting point plastic, and it's kind of glued onto the perimeter. I've already pried it off. On the back, you can see the circuitry inside. It's really amazing how much they pack in to operate just a light. It's not simple, quite sophisticated. And these pins that actually plug into the socket, seems here that what they've done is they've machined the glass casting. They've machined this very flat surface, I guess, so that these can be seated very flush. And inside, I can see that there's, I'll open it up in a moment, but there are a couple of leads there that are soldered to the circuit board. They go through this sort of plastic spacer, turn a right angle, and these pins, you see there, the leads just come through the pins, and they're crimped there just to hold the leads. So those leads would be very fragile. I could probably just pry those off the back, because that's really what's holding this in, as far as I can see. I've already pried the front off. Interesting, too, they have these little breathing holes here in the plastic face, which I guess because these bulbs are not sealed, allows air to get in and out as the bulb heats up and cools down. It's a very interesting diffusion lens. I wonder if they use computers to figure out an optimized lens like that, or if it's based on old school optical trickery to come up with a nice diffusion lens. But I think that's very pretty. It's very, very pretty diffusion lens. All right. So open up the front. There's a circuit board in the front and one in the back. So there's two circuit boards there, and they're perpendicular to one another. Interesting thing, too, is it shows here the back circuit board, it's not soldered to the front. There are these clips here, two of them, and those have leads which are just coming off the back circuit board. It's just pressed through those clips. So that looks like probably a sticky point, because I'm always very reluctant about sockets, especially where like current is concerned or where signal integrity is required. It just seems like that would be a vulnerable point for failure with oxidation, especially because this isn't sealed. Oxygen can get in there, and you would think that oxidation on those leads between the contact points, especially with the current that something like this would draw, I think that would be a point where this could fail. You know, I think that if they would have soldered that, it would be a much better guarantee. But hey, you know, maybe it's the reason this failed, who knows? Some kind of transistor on the front there. Transistor or voltage regulator or something. Got an array of 8 LEDs. And I did actually test these for ultraviolet, and I found that all of the IKEA lighting is all ultraviolet free, UVAB. I've tested all of the IKEA brand bulbs I have, and they're very consistent that none of them have any UVA or B. So I guess that's one of the things that they strive for, to make sure that they don't have any damaging ultraviolet emitting from their white LED lamps. I'm going to take those screws out. It's actually a machine screw. I was expecting that to be a self-tapper, but it's not. So all I have to do, I think, is pry these two pins off, and the whole thing should fall out. Unless that's glued in too, but that wouldn't make too much sense. No, it's loose. Okay. I would have thought this would have snapped off by now, but it's made of some rugged stuff. One is broken off inside. All right, they're both broken off. Oh, but it's not falling out. Of course, heatsink. Aluminum heatsink. I got some silicone goo on the back. That's obviously to take the heat from the LEDs. Of course, that makes more sense. Yeah, and those screws were tapped into the heatsink. So the weird thing is, I thought the glass was silvered because there's some mirroring in here. I thought the inside of the glass was silvered, and that's what would be reflecting, but it's actually this aluminum cone in here. And that looks like it's glued in place. Yep. It's glued in with silicone. Oh, wonderful. I don't want to break the glass. Come on. You can do it. There we go. There's the heatsink. All right. So it was a weird thing. Look, it is actually silvered inside. So that's wild. So they must have used this glass case must be for a halogen bulb that they've just retrofitted, because it's already been silvered inside. That's, you know, that's an expensive process, you know, vacuum process. That's wild. So yeah, kind of redundant, but I guess it shows that they're just using what's available, and so they're using the same glass from, you know, the halogen version to make the LED version. All right, well, there's the circuit board. Teeny tiny and very, very packed. Look at that. So it's got capacitors, it's got a little transformer, it's got a little inductor there, and that choke. It's got some resistors, precision resistors. This one has got some heat shrink on it, probably because it's near the mains. And on the bottom, I got surface mount. A little bridge rectifier in the back here. So that's just a simple bridge rectifier. Got a transistor here and chip. This chip is probably for the switching control. It's probably a DC to DC converter. It's basically rectifying voltage right off the mains, and then using a DC, you know, a buck boost converter, dropping the power down. And that would be your switching transformer. These film caps would be on the main side. So this electrolytic in the back here, the smaller one, is 120 volt rated. That's your two different sides of the DC to DC converter. And then the output pins go through the heat sink to the front board. Okay, well, that's it. That's all there is inside, but that's actually a lot of stuff just to be a lamp. There's a lot of materials in there, which begs the question, exactly how much energy does it take to create a bulb like this, as opposed to a halogen bulb that this replaces? It's a really, really big question, and I sure would like to know the answer. So the real question about LED lighting that remains unanswered, that I really have been trying to find an answer to, but there's just really no research, probably because there's really no way to compile data on this, but despite the fact that there are so many research studies that have been done that show the reduction in the carbon footprint of converting to solid-state LED lights as opposed to tungsten lights, there has been no data published about the actual carbon footprint of manufacturing these LED lights. And it's actually something to ponder, because you have to understand all these components and all these materials that go into making a light bulb that's meant to replace a much simpler to produce light bulb, like a halogen bulb, like the one that this replaced. The halogen bulb contains very few parts, very few types of materials. So there is a certain amount of energy that has to go into producing something like a halogen bulb. But for an LED bulb like this, it's much harder to grasp the carbon footprint of actually manufacturing the bulb. It's got a glass enclosure, so a glass is very energy intensive to mold and produce. It has plastic parts. It's filled with electronic components, semiconductors, a couple of PC boards. It's got inductors, it's capacitors, resistors, leads. It's got lots of different materials in here, plastics, metals. All those materials have to be, you know, mined from ores, refined, produced in factories, shipped all around the world, because the semiconductors and metals that go into making these, even if the components are manufactured in China, the raw materials come from all over the world, and they have to be refined and shipped by truck and by boat and by train, and all of that transportation is all based on burning fossil fuels. Ships run on oil, and trains run on diesel, and trucks run on diesel, and so there's a huge carbon footprint just to getting materials to China for the manufacturing. And then, of course, it takes a lot of energy to make everything, the circuit boards, the components, and also the manufacturing process of each individual part and putting it all together and everything. So I would think that the actual carbon footprint of a bulb like this would be significant enough that in order to overcome the carbon footprint of using the halogen bulb that it replaced, it would probably have to function for years, maybe 5 years at least, to overcome the difference in the carbon footprint of the manufacturing process and the things that go into there. Now, this bulb only lasted a year. I'd be very hard pressed. I'd really like to see the data that would show me conclusively that the carbon footprint that was created to make this bulb had been overcome by its 12 months of use over top of the energy savings of the halogen bulb that it replaced. If you take this and put it on the scale, on a global scale, replacing every light bulb and every fixture in like every office building, every factory, every, you know, big building, every apartment, every home, every street light and everything, things like you know, replacing like mercury vapor street lights with LED lights. I mean, some of the older alternatives were not highly inefficient as far as energy consumption goes compared to LED. But LED lighting, especially like in street lights, is causing actually other problems, where it's so bright and so blue that it's causing all kinds of problems with birds and insects and people's sleep cycles, and even the breeding of fireflies and such of that, just because we've changed the color of our lighting at night by switching to LEDs from these other more yellow-orange substitutes. It's hard to know, because like I said, there's no data, but the carbon footprint of manufacturing electronics like this is significant. And what's more, all this stuff is made in China for a reason, the reason being that in China, they don't care about pollution. The power used to make this bulb, it was coal. Their industrial sectors are powered by coal. Yeah, and also disposal of like the, you know, the waste materials and such. It's very sketchy in China. So, I opened it to discussion. If someone wants to run the numbers, if someone has data, I've really searched, looking for anyone who's ever done a study about the carbon footprint of, LED replacement lighting, and I just haven't been able to find it. So if you see it out there, if someone's done real numbers, I'm talking about speculation. I mean, like real numbers. I'd be very curious to read it. So I think that the bottom line is that if LED lighting lasted for decades, like if a bulb like this had a lifespan of like 20 years, hands down, the carbon footprint of the bulb would be significantly smaller than having a resistive lighting as a replacement for that. But the problem is LED lighting often doesn't really last that long. Depends on the brand and the cheapness and how it's made and everything. But this lasted 12 months. I've had other LED lamps that have lasted about that time, about a year. If it all lasted for decades, it wouldn't be a problem. But if they burn out in a few years, the cumulative effect of manufacturing all these bulbs, all the circuit boards, components, and everything, to be replaced every few years, it would be significant. The pollution and the carbon footprint of manufacturing all those components, all those circuit boards, would end up being significant. And it would almost be like a break-even thing with the energy that you're trying to save over the resistive lighting. So, anyway, that's it. That was my rant. All right. Thanks for watching. Thanks, too, to everyone on that there Patreon, making all these videos possible. It's really the only reason I'm able to do this is because of the support of all those amazing people down there on Patreon. So if you like what I do, if you like this video or any video of mine, consider becoming a patron. Just follow the link in the description. It's easy to do. Okay, thanks. I'm Fran. I'll be back here real soon. Despite the fact that there are so many research